into the presence of the Lord. Thankful to be here this morning. I want to read something out of Psalms 95. It says, "Oh, come, let us sing unto the Lord. Let us make a joyful noise to the rock of our salvation. Let us come before his presence with thanksgiving and make a joyful noise unto him with songs. For the Lord is great, and indeed we are all God. In his hands are the deep places, of the earth. The strength of the hills is also his. The sea is his, and he made it. And his hands formed the dry land. Come, let us worship and bow down. Let us kneel before the Lord our Maker. For he is our God, and we are the people of his pasture and the sheep of his hand. Today, as we will hear his voice, harden not your hearts." Today, we need to see who the God is in our life. We need to worship him with truth. We need to praise his name, because he has given us everything that we have today. He has given us the strength. He has given us the breath of our lungs to praise him, to magnify his name. What has he taught you out today? What has he let you overcome in your life? Let's worship him and praise him with everything that we have today. Come and worship the Lord.
Thank you. Oh Lord, we just want you. One thing have I desired of the Lord. Jesus, we only want you. Oh, we only want your presence in this place this morning. Oh, we're not satisfied, God. We're not satisfied.
No! Brother Billy. But what's been on my mind is not necessarily just that, but I've been thinking about all the things that I like about it. And something popped out to me that I never really thought of before, and it's not necessarily the hunting part of it that makes it that much great, but it's being outside, being outdoors, and just looking around at all the life that just springs forth from nothing. Because in the season, I'm a seasonal type of guy. I don't really care for summer and I don't really care for winter, but I love the two changes of seasons. I love the harvest time and fall, but I love spring too. And what I love about spring, Brother Connor, is all that life just pops up out of nowhere, Sister Lynn. It's like what appears to be dead. Everything's dead. There's nothing there. Leaves are gone. There's no green. There's no anything, Brother Blake. But then spring comes. And I'm reminded of it today as I wake up at the beautiful day we had. And how it affects us spiritually. Because scientifically, going through college and everything that I've done, we call that word dormancy. When a plant, they go into dormancy. And I looked that up, and that word comes from the Latin word dormir, which simply means to be asleep, to just be asleep. And from all appearances, during the winter, Brother Ronnie, it looks, everything's dead. From all appearances, everything's dead. There's no life. But that's when spring comes. And all of a sudden, we got green grass growing up off the dead ground. And we've got buds budding off of the tree limbs. And we've got turkeys in the distance gobbling. We've got birds chirping. And all this life comes from what seems to be dead. And I just can't help but think how many of our lives seem, from all appearances, gone. From what everybody can see, it looks like there's no life there. That this person's situation has got them too far gone. They made too many bad choices. They found their way. They made their bed here. So that's where they're going to be. But I came to tell somebody today that it may appear that everything's dead, but you're just dormant. There's been some dormant parts. Come on, I've been there. I woke up this morning with the devil instantly trying to do something, but then I walked outside and I said, this is too good of a day. Come on, Nick, there's too much beauty out here. Come on, I don't know what I'm going through, but when I look around from all appearances, it looks like there's death, but life arises. Going to be flipped. The season is going to change. Man, there's just a spirit in this place of transformation, really. I can't explain it. It ain't nothing about me. It ain't nothing about what I said. But that really is true. There is a change that is happening. Man. Allow God to just be God today. Amen. There's nowhere I'd rather be. There's nowhere I'd rather be. There's no place I'd rather be than here in the middle of my family, serving my God. Amen. There's power in that. Hallelujah. Amen. Sister Heidi, go get the different ways up there to give. We got Givelify, PayPal, available at riverbendpentecostals.com. Cash and checks can be mailed to Riverbend Pentecostals at P.O. Box 477, New Madrid, Missouri, 63869. We also have that number up there to give, 833-883-9311. And then we have the pins up here. The two closest to me are for your tithing, and the two outer pins are for your offerings. Amen. If you'll stand with me, and let's declare this together. Upon the authority of your word I have given, and it shall be given unto me, pressed down, shaken together, and running over. I am the tither, and I give my offerings. I bring them today into your storehouse. Therefore, the enemy is rebuked. The curse is broken. I live under an open heaven. You pour out upon me such a blessing that there's not enough room to receive it. We receive jobs and better jobs, raises and bonuses, staff and commissions, benefits and settlements, estates and inheritances, interest and income, rebates and returns,
last night. I'm going to talk to you for a few minutes. Last evening, about 45-ish, I had been at the church and then I went home. I came and prayed, and I'm very grateful for everyone that came and prayed their hour yesterday. This is the fruit of that prayer meeting. And as the pastor of this church, I feel very compelled to call you to prayer. There's not enough people coming to pray. We need your voice reaching for heaven. One Saturday a month, we pray from 6 a.m. to 6 p.m. Everyone signs up for an hour. Like you'd be there. About a quarter till 6 or so, I had been the night before. I woke up at 10 minutes till 3 and didn't go back to sleep until sometime between 5:30 and 6, maybe 5:30, something like that. I was just given out, and so I went home and I laid down while I took a nap. And I woke up about a quarter to 7. About 5 minutes later, my phone rang. It was Tripp. And he said, "Where are y'all at?" And I said, "Well, I'm home." And Mama's at the church, and I don't know where Garrison and Carly are. But there's been a very bad accident out on Highway 61. And
what?
Well, when my daddy died in 1997, that just to be real close to the same time that all three of my brothers lost their minds and became worse sinners than they had been. And they liked to roam and run all hours of the night. And every time I heard a siren, I went into a panic. Like, not normal, but a panic. Like, I'm hyperventilating and I can't breathe. And so I get up at 2, 3, 4, whatever time the siren goes off, and I get my clothes on and I go chase it down, Brother Jerry, because I had to know it wasn't my brother. Well, I about got the victory over that, but last night it came back. Now, I didn't have a clue in the world who was in that accident, but I started praying, pleading the blood, praying over my family, my friends, my loved ones. And when that happens, this is the way it works for me. I start thinking about everybody who I don't want it to be. But I ran into a problem last night because there was nobody that I wanted it to be. And I started praying over our city. And I started praying over every parent and every child that attends our schools. And I felt a wave of awareness that that's how God feels every time we are in an accident in life. Every time things don't go right in our life, the Lord doesn't want that to be you. And there is nobody that doesn't matter to God. And today you came here. Many of you, if not all, came here in need. Your minds are assaulted. Your hearts are assaulted. Your body is assaulted. Somewhere, somehow, some way, you're under attack. And you came here today discombobulated in your life. And the Lord has come into this place to minister today and to tell you that He knows where you are. And to tell you that He wins every battle. His victory doesn't look always like the victory we want it to look. Now, in 1 Corinthians chapter number 12, there are relayed to us 9 gifts of the Spirit. That does not mean there are only 9, but there are 9 clearly delineated in 1 Corinthians chapter number 12, verses 8, 9, and 10. They are often divided into 3 groups, with the first three groups of 3. The revelation gifts include the word of wisdom, the word of knowledge, and the discerning of spirits. The power gifts include faith, gifts of healing, and working of miracles. The vocal gifts include speaking in other tongues, the interpretation of tongues, and prophecy. Now that is not an exhaustive list, but it is one. What happened in here today is the gift of tongues and interpretation, and also the gift of tongues has been here. That the gift of tongues is when people speak in tongues for themselves. It may be heard by you, it may be audible, you may understand it, but it is for personal edification. For instance, when someone is worshiping, they're off by themselves, and they just begin to speak in other tongues, that is edification for the body, the individual. That is not for the edification of others. The gift of tongues and interpretation is when one speaks in an unknown tongue, and the Spirit, in my experience, and I believe the Bible backs it up, the Spirit makes way for that. And things begin to quiet down. And someone will speak in other tongues, in an unknown tongue, and it will be more demonstrative and more of the focus of the service. And then immediately following that, they or someone else will interpret that. Now the Bible teaches very plainly that that will always happen involving 2 people, or at the most by 3. And then it will happen in order. They'll never talk over top of one another. It will not be confusing. But that is for the edification of the church. And what the word of the Lord said to us this morning, in essence, was, I speak, but you don't listen. Now, I'm going to tell you, I feel the Holy Ghost leading me right now. That is, of course, always going to encapsulate the preaching of the word. Because the preaching of the word is designed to save them that believe. The Bible says he chose the foolishness of preaching, which doesn't mean we act a fool. It means that the essence of the message will be foolish to the carnal mind. All right? But the plan of God, the wisdom of God, confounds the wisdom of the world. And the wisdom of God is foolishness to the world. So, the Lord today said, I speak and you don't listen. Here is this message from heaven that I'm going to point you to, and then we're going to give you an opportunity to respond, and then we are going to the house. 2:00 in the morning, I woke up. I always touch my phone to see if anyone's called me. I leave my phone on silent. Because some of y'all ain't got no manners. And y'all think if you get up at 4:00 in the morning, pastor wants to hear from you at 4:00 in the morning. That ain't true. This is true. This is not pastor being trying to be funny. It's true. Is that not the case? My wife and I were getting woke up, and when I wake up to go to the bathroom or whatever in the middle of the night, I'm up. My wife can wake up and be asleep before she lays back down. I can't do that. So we have our phone on silent. So I prayed and prayed and prayed for those that were involved in the accident, and I don't even know who all it was, and I still prayed for their healing and for their safety, and I don't know the ramifications of it or anything. I'm just talking about how I felt, and I began to pray for them, and I don't even know who they are. But at 2:00 in the morning, I punched my phone and I had 2 missed calls beginning at midnight. It usually wakes me up. It didn't last night. I apologize for that. But beginning at midnight or so, Sister Meredith had called me. And then at about 2:03, Brother Shannon had called me. And he had called me twice as well. So I called him back. And he said, we're at the hospital and we think Meredith is in labor. Now, I knew that Meredith was not ready to, at least in my mind, ready for the baby to be born. And it terrified me. So I tried to do the old lay there and pray for a minute. And that didn't work out so well for me. So I got up, I got my phone and my watch, and I took everything to the living room that I was going to need to get ready for church. And I began to pray. And I prayed scared. And I'm going to tell you what, there's a difference in just praying and praying scared. And I began to travail and I began to pray. And I didn't really know a whole lot of different things to say. So I began to say, plead the blood of Jesus over the baby. I plead the blood of Jesus over Mary and over Richard and over Brother Shannon and Sister Stacy. And I just began to pray. And then I began to think about what I was going to preach today, which I will preach again if the Lord would lead. And I began to realized I didn't know how to pray. I didn't know what to pray. I just was scared. And Brother Jerry, the book says, but ye, beloved, building up yourselves on your most holy faith, praying in the Holy Ghost. And I knew there was one who knows what to do. And so I began to try to yield myself to the Holy Ghost.
Right.
And I began to tell the Lord, me praying ain't cutting.
Right.
I need the Spirit to go to work. I know you. I know you are a God that heals. And I know that you are a God that delivers. And I know that you are a God that speaks and things are created. And I know that you are a God that loves us. And you are a God that's mindful of us. And you are a God that is aware of us. And I don't know really what's going on, but I know you. And I immediately began to pray in the Holy Ghost. I began to speak in other tongues and under the influence of the Holy Ghost. And I began to shake and I began to quiver and I began to feel peace.
Yeah.
Because I couldn't find it in my mind, because I was thinking of all the different scenarios and all the different hypotheses. Yeah. And they were all not what I wanted. But I knew there was a place in the Spirit. And what I come to tell you today is your place is in the Spirit. It's not my place. means. It's a universal sign. Everybody knows it. I surrender and I say, Lord, lost. Lord, I'm weak. Lord, my mind is messed up. But I heard the word. And the word said, you never lost a battle. And you never will. So I come today to move to the winning side. My way didn't get it done. The way of the world didn't get it done. I hadn't found no answers on Facebook, even though 27 million people told me they were praying. I didn't find any answers. I don't understand everything that went on here today. All I know is I feel something inside of me. Calling. Drawing. Pulling. And telling me that you've got this. So I'm going to move from the flesh over to the spirit. And the way I do that is I remind you I'm not God. I'm weak. I'm unable to control my tendency to do the wrong thing. My life is unmanageable. But you are a God of order. And you spoke. And I will listen. Here we go. I am weak. Thou art strong. Jesus, keep me from all wrong. I'll be satisfied as long as I walk. Let me walk close to thee. God right now, tell him, I'm weak, but you're strong. helpless, but you're not. I'm hopeless, but you give hope. God, I surrender my life to you, everything, my mind, my heart, my mouth, my eyes, my ears, my hands, my feet, all of me I give to you. I surrender. I surrender. I surrender. Lead me, Lord, I'll follow. Choreographs everything Pentecostal style. He moves the way you need him to move. I know. I don't know if you want to play or not. You just do whatever the Lord leads you. I know that in secret places, hidden places, private places that you don't want to talk about, the Lord has spoken to you. I know He has reached for you, and He has led you, and it has given birth to a hunger inside of you, but you're scared. Well, let me tell you, first off, being afraid doesn't put you in a boat by yourself. Because what God's fixing to do in your life is worth being afraid of. Because it's so much more powerful than what you've been doing. It's so much more rich than what you've been doing. It's so much more complete than where you've been. But God has spoken to you. He spoke to us as a church through the gift of tongues and interpretation. And He said, I spoke, but you didn't listen. You've got the opportunity right now. This is not manipulation. This is not guilting you. It's not trying to scare you. This is not playing games. This is truth. You have the opportunity right now to respond to the word that's your word. Not the one that everybody gets, but the one that you've been getting. When you've been crying in your sleep, when you've been having dreams about things God wants to do in your life, when you stand and look at your spouse and you're frustrated out of your mind because you don't know which way to go or what to do, God has spoke.
Right.
Now you must respond.
Yes.
Yes,
sir. We're not looking for hype. We're not looking for pomp and circumstance. We're looking for honesty. And the Lord is going to honor that honesty in this room right now. You don't have to be well-schooled at knowing how to pray. You just got to know how to surrender. The Spirit will step in and take care of you. Reach, reach, reach.
Oh,
And then ladies' conference is April the 25th through the 27th at the Chateau on the Lake in Branson, Missouri. Registration is $70. After April the 8th, it's $90. And there's a QR code below to register on the board.